And my mother, my mother says, "Well, we waited long enough. I'm getting a television." Good morning, Shelly.
Good morning, Ernie. How are you?
I'm good. I'm good. We'll wait a few minutes. Is there anything we need to do? I'm going to talk to my co-host here.
No, Rob is working with Shelly this morning, and he's going to share her presentation when it's time.
Oh, okay.
And we already went over that, so we should be good to go. You don't have your camera on, Ernie, so you should...
On top of your computer, Ernie, maybe there's a camera.
There is a camera up there, but I don't know how to turn it on from here. Let me go to do this. Now I can see a place where I can turn it on, I think. Here we go.
All right.
Good looking guy, right?
Definitely.
Well, I'm the co-host on it. She's also our technical director, and she will be controlling the mics. Most everybody will be muted. The only persons that will have an open mic all the time is me, Lynn, and the super and the commissioner. So the time when you wanted to make that statement, Lynn.
On That's how okay, Ernie. No worries.
All right. What we're going to do at the end, or as we get finished with the presentation from Commissioner LaRose, is we're going to open up the microphone so other people can join the conversation. In the meantime, the only persons that might want to interrupt the commissioner is me and Lynn, as we see things that need clarification. Other than that, we will wait till an appropriate time when the commissioner is finished to have a conversation. Then everybody will be invited.
Yeah, let me break in right there, Ernie. If anybody has a question for the commissioner, you can put it in the chat window, or you can raise your hand and I will unmute you at the end of the presentation so you could ask your question. And how you do that is you do Alt Y or Option Y, and star 9 if you're on a phone only, okay?
Traditionally, we do start off with the national anthem. Are we ready to key that up, Lynn?
We are. Let me just change my share here. And here we go. Whoop, I forgot one thing.
What's that?
There we go.
Can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the
those guys are good.
Yeah, they're really great, aren't they?
Yeah. I want to pay attention to our supporters here. Our annual supporters are Toomey, Latham, Shea, Kelly, Dubin, and Quantero. It's a wonderful law firm. And Louis Joe Zavilli's law firm. They're both excellent law firms who are, you know, hallmarks of good legal work. And then we have Covant Energy and Gershow Recycling, both very, very responsible corporate citizens, and I want to thank them. Throughout the year, if we didn't have them, it wouldn't exist, I'll tell you that much. But today's sponsor are Executive Airways, Executive Flightways. Executive Flightways is one of our program sponsors today, and they have a long-established private service there, and they've been around for 40 years or more. Their fleet of aircraft is among the most luxuriously appointed and well-maintained, and they maintain their facilities at the airport that our commissioner is in charge of. Under the leadership of their president, John Grillo, they have endeavored to achieve the highest quality of comfort and safety in flight. We thank them for helping us make this Limbo program succeed. Our second sponsor is the firm of Ruskow, Moscow, and Faltashek. Alex Bateman is representing them today, and he'd like to make a few statements of his own.
Good morning, Ernie, and thank you, Ernie and Lynn, and good morning to everybody else. We're pleased to be a sponsor of this event this morning. I've been a partner at Ruskin Moscow Faltashek for about 24 years now, heading up our healthcare and our white collar criminal defense group. But as many of you on the call know, the firm's been around practicing on Long Island in the region for more than 50 years now, representing our clients in corporate and securities matters, real estate, commercial litigation, trusts and estates, financial services, and very topical these days, our rapidly growing cybersecurity practice group. We are and always have been pleased to serve the corporate needs and the individual needs of all of our clients on Long Island and the region. We look forward to continuing to do that into 2021. And in some respects, like all of us, looking to get 2020 behind us. We are especially looking forward this morning to hearing from Commissioner LaRose and are anxious to hear about the developments at MacArthur Airport, because all of us on this call, both from a business standpoint and from a personal standpoint, benefit tremendously from all the great things being done at MacArthur Airport. So let's get to the program, and we just want to wish everybody a happy holidays. And make sure that you're safe and enjoy the holidays as well as going into the new year. Thanks, Ernie.
Thanks, Alex. And I just want to say on a personal note, but with the firm, I've been friends with the partners over there for many years. And Alex has been to many, many of our meetings over the years as well. And we like that relationship. I'm glad it exists. Our speaker this morning is a person who is a professional person in the field of the management of an airport. She's Shelly LaRose Arkin, and she's actively involved in the aviation field for 32 years and worked at the Spirit of St. Louis Airport in Cincinnati, Northern Kentucky Airport, Westchester County and Republic, and currently serves as the Commissioner of Aviation for Long Island's MacArthur and Bayport airports. She is a graduate of the Florida Tech in Aviation Management and Flight Technology, and is a commercial instrument and multi-engine pilot since 1988. The speaker gives opening remarks between 10 and 15 minutes, and I want to welcome Shelly to the program this morning. Good morning, Shelly.
Good morning, Ernie. Thank you very much for having us. And Lynn, I might want to unmute, if you don't mind, Angie Carpenter, the town supervisor, as well as Rob Schneider, the deputy commissioner, who's going to help me with the presentation this morning. But first, before we get started, I really want to thank the sponsors as well. Executive Flightways has been a longtime partner here at the airport. Rushkin and Moscow, obviously very, very close to the airport, and a strong leader in Long Island. So with all these wonderful sponsors today, we really appreciate that. And I know Limba does just a fabulous job of getting information out to the businesses and individuals who make Long Island tick. So thank you, Ernie, for keeping this going. Rob is going to share his screen with us. And if the supervisor is unmuted, I'd like to introduce her really quick for some remarks.
I did unmute her. So Angie Carpenter, if you could push the unmute button on your side, then you should be able to speak. You should be seeing Rob's presentation, which we are now. Great.
Okay, well, let me introduce her really quick, but I think that she's probably in the listening mode right now. So hopefully she'll join us before the presentation concludes. But Angie Carpenter is the town supervisor of Islip. She is also our leader for Long Island MacArthur Airport, and we are super fortunate to have her. She is a visionary, and she's really turned this airport around in the last 4 years, 5 years that she has been supervisor. She takes a very active role in what our mission is, what our strategies are, and we're very fortunate to have her as a leader. I'd also like to introduce quickly Rob Schneider, who's been at the airport for more than 15 years. He's also has a master's degree from Dowling College in Aviation. He is truly the best partner I've ever had in working with. We think a lot alike, so it's just a pleasure to work with him every day. We're gonna kind of share the opportunity to present this to you today. We think that's kind of important because on Zoom, it's a little bit different and we don't want you to get bored of listening to me. So we're gonna talk about crisis in aviation. It sounds really, really negative. But at the same time, I think when we get to the end of this presentation, you'll see what our strategy is and how Long Island and the businesses and the passengers here and the travelers here and the customers of Long Island are really going to be in a different place as we enter 2021. And we see a very positive outlook for this airport. So we've been doing a lot of groundbreaking things we're going to talk about today, and we'll talk about quarantines and we'll talk about safety of flying towards the end too. So we have about 16 slides, and we're going to talk about what happened to demand, what our strategy is, and how we rally as Long Islanders to recover our economy, our airport, and our businesses. So next slide, please. And I'm going to turn it over to Rob at this point.
Morning, everybody. Thank you for having us. As you can obviously tell from the name of the PowerPoint presentation, Crisis in Aviation, we're currently going through the biggest crisis in aviation history. Unfortunately, the COVID-19 pandemic has been the largest impact on aviation, larger than 9/11, also larger than the Great Recession. We have a quote from Gary Kelly at the top, which we believe holds true, that air carrier demand is not going to return until the vaccines are available and it's widespread and people can be inoculated, or until there's a real viable therapeutic use drug to treat the infection of COVID-19. Since August of 2020, we've been operating about 30% of our total demand from where we were last year, year over year. Sounds scary. We'll get into a little more detail on that later on throughout the presentation, but Long Island MacArthur Airport is actually faring better than all large hub airports throughout the United States, and also faring pretty well amongst other small regional airports as well. You can see that U.S. domestic airlines reported second quarter losses of over $10 billion. They expected third quarter losses to be continuously on the decline. They lose more money. IATA, which is the International Aviation Transportation Association, is predicting that the industry will post upwards of $84 billion in annual losses as a direct result of the pandemic. There's going to be over 30,000 layoffs that have been announced since October 1st, and that's basically hitting almost all of the airlines, with the exception of some of the ultra low cost carriers that have a business model that's able to help with cost savings, which in turn helps keep employees on the payroll. There have been approximately 700 U.S. domestic routes that have been permanently cut. Some of those routes, obviously by permanently, we don't expect them to return at all. Some of these routes will never be restored to these specific airports by their associated air carrier partners. Some examples of that, we'll start with Westchester County Airport. At one point, Westchester County Airport had no commercial operations at all. Commissioner, you could correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe it was about 3 months where Westchester County did not have any commercial service. So that's they saw a decline.
What does that mean, Rob, in terms of how can they run the airport at all if you're at 99% decline?
Westchester County essentially reverted from a commercial airport to a general aviation airport. So the airport was still open and operating, but there were no commercial activities. Their air carrier partners, American Airlines, JetBlue, they all decided to cease service during the pandemic due to suppressed demand. So there were no commercial activities at the terminal. The terminal was not operating, but the airport itself still was. There were still general aviation, light general aviation, and corporate activity at the airport. Another example was Stewart International Airport in Newburgh. That airport's on 93% decline in their traffic. They went from having a significant daily commercial operation down to having one flight every 4 days throughout the pandemic, and their numbers still have not recovered nearly to where they were pre-pandemic. We're lucky in the fact that we are down significantly, as I said earlier, in commercial operations, but we're operating right now currently at around 2015 service levels. So we're in between anywhere from 8 to 12 flights a day, which is really not that bad considering the current situation with COVID. The Port Authority of New York and New Jersey, which obviously runs the major New York City metropolitan airports, it runs Stewart. It also runs Kennedy, LaGuardia, and Newark International Airport, as well as Teterboro GA Airport. And they're seeking an additional $3 billion in CARES funds because they just don't have the money to continue to make payroll and also to continue with their capital improvements that have been planned as part of their big redevelopment projects. Unfortunately, the Port Authority is looking at laying off approximately 600 people.
What's going on with that overvoice?
Yeah, let me just...
No, that's our radio in the background, Lynn.
Oh, okay.
Is it the overvoice or is it the static?
I was looking to see if somebody was chatting.
It's our operations radios in the background, no problem. But what's really super important about this is that on day one of the pandemic, the Port Authority was operating at a deficit. So we really recognize that there are a lot of airports that were in a very bad financial position day one of this pandemic, which is not Long Island MacArthur Airport. And what is terrific is that while other airports, as Rob said, had lost service completely or lost particular routes, we did not see that happen here. And I'll let Rob continue, but it's really good news for us.
Yes, it is. You know, LaGuardia obviously was already financially burdened prior to the COVID-19 pandemic. The COVID pandemic will exacerbate their financial burdens. They're not expecting to recover until at least 2027 is their projection right now, which is certainly a long ways away for them. they will continue to report revenue losses throughout that time and also continue to see a decrease in flight activity as well. So certainly not good news for the Port Authority, but the silver lining for us is that there's a huge opportunity for us to be able to capitalize on that. And as I said earlier, since March, MacArthur Airport's capacity has been about 40 to 50% of our 2019 levels, which roughly puts us at 2015 service levels.
So, Rob, your situation at the airport, is as bad as it is not nearly as bad as some of the other places that you're citing.
Exactly. It's not a good situation by any means. All airports are struggling right now. Rough order of magnitude, when you compare us to the other 1,000-something airports throughout the country, Long Island MacArthur Airport is actually doing quite well. With
I love using your airport, by the way. It's such a pleasure to go in and, you know, be treated like a human being instead of a cattle yard.
Yes, we agree. We certainly think that our customer experience is superior to any other New York airport in the metropolitan area. And in fact, not being biased, but when I travel, I try to travel exclusively from this airport also, just because I'd prefer the stress-free, more pleasant customer experience than going to the Port Authority airports. So thank you for being a loyal customer, Ernie.
Not recently, but...
Yeah, we understand. So we have a line graph that's up here on the screen for you guys to see right now. This was from the Steer Group. They're a business analytical group that studies current patterns within business and trend lines, along with IATA, who I mentioned before, the International Association of Travel. They have also been studying the recovery for COVID-19 and for air carriers and airlines and the industry in general. And what you'll see here is the different lines. You can see IATA is in orange with their recovery range. The Steer Group is in the light blue, and then there's another Steer recovery in the dashed light blue line, which is projecting recovery to be till 2024 is when most airports will reach their pre-COVID numbers. After further research, because this data is a bit older now, and by older we mean a few months, and as we know, the pandemic is evolving on a regular basis, which makes the economy and the airline industry and aviation industry evolve on a semi-regular basis as well. Those recovery timelines could stretch out even further, as the Port Authority is projecting LaGuardia Kennedy won't reach pre-COVID levels until 2027. So what we're seeing right now is the smaller airports like MacArthur Airport are going to recover significantly quicker than the Port Authority airports are, for a multitude of reasons. First one being, the Port Authority airports generally focus on the business traveler. Obviously, what we're doing right now, zooming in, this technology happens to work, and it works fairly well. And businesses are shifting the paradigm of how they're going to operate for the foreseeable future as a result of COVID. So forecasters aren't overly optimistic right now that the business traveler is, or the business demand for the business traveler isn't going to return for the foreseeable future. But what we do know is that there's a lot of pent-up demand for the leisure market. There's a lot of people that just want to go out and get on a plane and go take a vacation somewhere nice and get away, especially after being in this terrible situation now for almost a year. MacArthur Airport is primarily a leisure market airport. The majority of our travelers are leisure travelers. So we'll start to see those recovery numbers happen. We feel like as soon as the vaccine becomes more widely available to the public. We also think that we hold a significant advantage because the Port Authority airports are always very, very crowded. If you can imagine a time when you've traveled out of Kennedy or LaGuardia, it's always packed wall to wall full of people. You have a long line that you're standing in for food and beverage, long line that you're standing in for TSA checkpoints. MacArthur Airport, you're not going to have those long lines. Our TSA checkpoints are super efficient. You get through them always 15 minutes or less. Sometimes it's 5 minutes or less. We don't have long lines in our food and beverage concessions in our food court. And there's enough room for people to kind of space out while they're waiting for their flight. So we do think that between the health and safety advantages that we can provide, plus the better customer experience, and then compounded on the fact that we're a leisure-based airport and not so much a business-based market, we are anticipating our recovery to be significantly quicker than the Port Authorities and even quicker than what IATA and Steer Group is representing on this screen.
So what we did, and we feel like we're probably one of the few airports that has taken a hard look since the beginning of the pandemic to say, hey, where do we sit? How do we compare to our competitors and things like that? So what this graph shows is basically common destinations that are served by MacArthur, JFK, and LaGuardia. And if you take a look at the dark blue line, that's actual service levels from the beginning of the year. So where Rob was at the very top of that line, that's, you know, early, we started out the year really good, very strong for January, February. Of course, you know, March 13th was a D-Day for all of us, right? And you know, service then collapsed, and it really, the carriers right-sized for demand and adjusted their schedules accordingly. And if you can take a look from April, and all the way up through basically July 4th weekend, you see demand recovering very fast. The yellow line that's in there represents JFK actual traffic. The green line, whoops, on the one before that, Rob. Sorry, the green line, represents LaGuardia service. So you could see Long Island MacArthur Airport for the same destinations served by our competitors did much better. And are still doing much better than JFK and LaGuardia. What's interesting about this is during that period of time, there were no quarantine restrictions. So you could see demand was recovering very nicely right up until the quarantine restrictions came into play, which was July 4th weekend. And then it dropped off again. And then we, you know, passengers and airlines became more optimistic again through late summer and early fall. And then of course, round two, basically late fall, we started seeing service drop off again. A lot of it relative to the number of cases that started to rise and for COVID cases. So there we are.
The pale lines, are they projections or the vaccine effect?
You're absolutely right, Ernie. So the pale lines were all forecasts, and that takes us basically October through the end of the year. And you can see that the pale lines increased in terms of level of service. We were really forecasting for November and December at the point at which we ran this, because this was in September. But it actually is further projected into quarter one of 2021 now. So what's interesting about this is that, and Rob alluded to it, but JFK, if you think about it, is predominantly international service, right? So international service will come back later than even leisure travel and domestic service. LaGuardia is primarily a business traveler airport, usually served by those folks who either live in the city or work in the city. And the city has not recovered and is not expected to recover in terms of business for a long period of time. So those lines, we expect Long Island MacArthur Airport to exceed them as we go out in terms of actuals. And we think that there's a different type of business traveler that we're having. And Rob talked about the opportunities with technology and Zoom and things like that. But if you recall, and if you're listening to the news is saying, you know, We've told our employees not to come back to the city until, you know, summer of next year. And some of the businesses are actually giving up their leases in the city. So we think to keep really a corporate culture going, that if they are headquartered or they do have offices in New York City, that they're going to continue to allow that individual who may be working from Tampa, Florida, or from Wisconsin, or wherever they relocated to, or Long Island, New York, right? That they will actually only be called to the city maybe once a week, maybe once a month. So that's going to be our new form of business traveler, we think, if we look into our crystal ball, which is kind of interesting. But it works for airports like us. It's an
overall advantage. Do you see a rise in the use of airlines service?
So
what I mean to say is more than the normal that you had once everything settles in.
A little bit, yes. Yeah, it's going to be, you know, through the end of 2021 before we see that. We really see recovery, you know, to our 2019 levels, and that's our next chart. So good question, Ernie. Let's go to that next chart. There we go. So on the next chart, the dark blue line is, again, actual 2020. So we started out really strong, again, January, February. We had 17 and 19, 20 average daily departures. We dropped down to one in April, you know, due to COVID. We had recovery going up to 12, 10. So you can see that we did fairly well considering. These are just Long Island MacArthur Airport departures. If you look at the gray line above it, that gray line represents 2019 levels. So you can see when we closed out 2019, we were up to 23 average daily departures. That was awesome. So that's what our goal is, Ernie. We're trying to get back to that number. And the green line in the middle of this graph actually represents our 2021 projections through first quarter. So we're still around 10 average daily departures, which is our 2015 service levels. We believe that strengthens as we move into 2021 because of the vaccines and and hopefully some reduced travel restrictions as well. And then, you know, and people feel more confident in traveling. So we're hoping that by the end of the year that we get up to those 2019 levels. It's aggressive. It's super aggressive. But we've got the right carriers with point-to-point service. Frontier is excellent in terms of the point-to-point service. We've seen a lot of passengers, you know, enjoying those flights. And we think that's going to help us to continue. Remember, Frontier was one of the very few carriers who actually announced new service coming in 2021 in the middle of the pandemic, right? So now March 18th of 2021, Frontier is doing nonstop service to Las Vegas. So we think that's going to be a very successful flight. Obviously, Long Islanders love that flight. So,
hey, Shelly, I think the last time you and I spoke, Limba, which was at the Courtyard Marriott, somebody specifically was asking about Las Vegas flights returning to Islip. So it's exciting that a year after meeting with you guys in the midst of the pandemic, the commissioner gets to share with you guys that we not only have navigated these troubled waters, but we've actually gotten the service to Vegas restored by one of our carrier partners.
So if there are no questions, we'll go on to the next slide, basically. There we go. So what are we doing? Our goal for 2021 and the end of this year, obviously, was to protect our profit and loss, protect our P&L, make sure that, you know, we're financially stable. We're continuing, you know, just because we had a pandemic, the supervisor, the deputy, and I, and our really great air service team have continued to recruit air carrier and also prioritize what the airlines need. We were able to offer deferrals to them in terms of payments to help them out, encourage them to stay here. Our competitors did not. We were innovative and hopefully helped them financially survive, you know, some of this. So I think they recognize that we are an excellent partner. And I think that's why Frontier took that really aggressive step to say, hey, listen, you know, we're gonna add service. We'll go on to the next one. So what did our financials look like in 2019? We were doing great. We had, at the end of 2019, we had $6.7 million put away in surplus funds. What that means is basically it's 6 months worth of operating income to us. So we were sitting in a very good position, not like the Port Authority who was operating at a deficit on the day that the pandemic began. In 2020, We were very fortunate. The carriers, the airports all received CARES Act funding. Hopefully your businesses did, if you took advantage of some of those small business loans and things like that. There are certainly opportunities out there, and we were very fortunate to get $7.1 million, which again is a little, it's about 7 months worth of operating income to us. So we've been living off of that for, you know, we lost one of our rental car companies, declared bankruptcy. But for the most part, all of our tenants have really, really buckled down and, you know, worked very hard to keep their businesses going so that 2021 looks a lot better for us. So our goal this year is just basically to break even. You know, we'd like to see that happen. I think today we're supposed to hear something about possibly additional CARES Act funding. We're still hoping to get more grants. And I should point out very quickly that we don't take local taxpayer dollars. All of our funding comes from grants from the FAA, from the state. There's a state aviation fund. We take advantage of any type of opportunity that might be out there. There's some transportation grants that we've applied for. So most of our operating income is all from grants. So it's worked very well for us. We'll go on to the next slide.
I just piggyback on that, working very well for us. As a supervisor of the town, and so absolutely thrilled that one of our assets is Long Island MacArthur Airport, to be able to say to our taxpayers, to our residents, you have this asset, you have this resource here right at your disposal, and it doesn't present a burden at all to the taxpayer. Not one taxpayer dollar goes to sustain the airport. So, you know, that hasn't always been the case, and I have to publicly salute, you know, the team that's in place there. Certainly Shelly is the commissioner and Rob is the deputy. They stay focused, looking at every opportunity for every dollar that we can get and never being a burden on the taxpayer. So it really works well. So I want to thank you for that.
Great.
Thank you, Supervisor Carpenter.
So Rob, we'll move on to your branding focus. So we'll talk about this for a few minutes. So what were we doing in 2017 to 2019? We developed a new branding message called Fly More, Stress Less, obviously capitalizing on the benefits and the experience of flying out of an airport that's less crowded and has more efficient lines. In 2020, we had planned to launch the similar campaign on May 4th. And ironically, we switched gears very, very quickly to focus on health and safety. And we wanted to talk about, you know, being relevant in the marketplace, but being sensitive to the pandemic and what was going on. So we came up with a message, we're here when you're ready. And we launched that campaign on May 4th. It's still running. It's a digital campaign. That's our creative strategy for it. And it's being served up in messages. And what we're able to do, it's a digital program. So we're able to watch consumer behavior. So when you saw those lines increasing in the summer months, we could see that people wanted to know more about who flies out of MacArthur, where do we fly to? And then we were able to change that message to the next creative message, which was basically about health and safety. But this was a different type of campaign than we thought about launching. But what we recognized is during a crisis, if you are in the marketplace, you're often able to shift the market more towards your product and service versus somebody else. And at the same time, Frontier for MacArthur was in the marketplace. Southwest did have some advertising in the marketplace also related to MacArthur. But LaGuardia and Kennedy were completely out of the marketplace during that time. So it's been a really good program that we've been running. I think, you know, some of the other things when we started the year off, we were the number six small airport in the country, according to USA Today. And thank you all who may have participated and voted for us. One of our partners, the Long Island Ducks, and Frank Bolton and his team were really amazing in getting out the message and getting us some votes too. So thank you for helping us to get to number six. We also partnered with Altice, and Altice gave us free advertising on their travel and weather channel. And that promoted about 1.4 million impressions, all earned media. We didn't pay for it. They've been our partner before in paid media campaigns, and they agreed to carry our message forward throughout the summer. So that was fabulous. We also launched a whole bunch of health and safety measures. We'll talk about those in a minute. The Today Show actually ran a segment on it, which created 3.3 million impressions. And it equates to about $500,000 in earned media because we were able to get that message out. So we do like to take advantage of, you know, local media, you know, media that's, you know, on the, as national as the Today Show. And anytime that we can get free or earned media, it's fabulous because our program is about $200,000 a year. That we typically spend, which is very conservative in terms of all of the messaging and the impressions that we're getting out there. So really exciting. So our focus basically going into 2021 is rebuilding, partnering, rebuilding. We recognize that we have to do this together. Rob, I'm gonna turn it over to you. Did I miss anything on those? This is the campaign for health and safety, right? We can't hear you.
It would help if I unmuted myself. Thank you.
happens all the time, Rob. No worries.
Thank you. So this is the transition into our creative strategy after the Here and Now campaign. This strategy is more effective for companies to utilize when demand starts to return. So this is focusing again on more products and services. So we'll be transitioning back to this as we start to see demand return again.
Shelly, I'd like to introduce a new thought here. We have a new president who is very friendly to rail traffic. And my the team, the Maglev people we have in Washington, has communications with the new president. Mm-hmm. What happens when Maglev becomes the method of a choice to go from, say, here to Washington, or from here to Boston, or even here to Chicago, because a maglev can do that in 3 hours, which is less time than an airplane when you consider the time loss. Are you thinking in those terms?
You know, we don't serve, we serve Baltimore, Washington, Southwest does that nonstop service. The flight is 40 minutes. If you're coming out of a smaller airport and you don't have to arrive 3 hours early, you're certainly saving time. It's definitely less stressful if you've sometimes just getting on, you know, other modes of transportation can be equally as stressful. You still have to arrive a little bit early. So I think it just, you know, we only have a few destinations that are closed, but they're really for connecting passengers as well. You know, Philadelphia is very close. You know, Baltimore, Washington service is close, but we don't have anything right into DC, you know, at the other two airports there. So
I think it would certainly relieve the major airports of those shorter flights and probably not affect you as much. Is that your assessment?
I would say yes.
Yeah. Anybody has some questions, let us know. We'll introduce you into the conversation. Unless you have more. Rob, do you have more?
Rob's got a few more slides.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So some of the technology that we implemented immediately as a result of the pandemic, first thing that we did was try to introduce pathogen reduction. We were the first airport in the world to actually utilize this technology. It's exciting for us. The technology has been around for a while. It's been utilized in hospitals where obviously pathogens are paramount and they need to reduce them operating rooms. But it's never been introduced into a place like an airport terminal before. So it was very exciting for us to be on the cutting edge at the very beginning of the pandemic in April to launch this technology and to be number one in the world. We also installed on our high touch surface location, something called Silver Defender, which is a strip of silver ion that gets wrapped around high touch surfaces. And upon touch, the silver deactivates pathogens such as bacteria and viruses, killing it on contact. We were also the first airport in the world to deploy this technology. A lot of the method behind the deployment of this technology at the beginning was just to make sure that the employees that were here on the front lines, the essential workers that stayed here throughout the pandemic, had a level of comfort to come into work and know that they're in a safe environment. But equally as important to that was making sure that we started to respond to the consumer to get them more comfortable with flying again and start restoring that consumer confidence. So we were also among the first airports, I think we were either number two or number three, to install a personal protective equipment PPE vending machine. That's located right outside of the security checkpoint for passengers that may have forgotten hand sanitizer, face coverings, Tylenol, any of those type of needs. They'd be able to purchase it from our PPE vending machine and take it with them on their way to get on their flight.
Rob?
Yes.
Just a quick time warning here. It's 9:45. We do want to have a little bit of time for questions, and we're supposed to break at 10. So just kind of letting you know if you want to cover the last couple of slides quickly so we can have some time for some good Q&A here. We're already starting to get some questions in the chat here.
Sure.
Thank you.
So we're also transitioning to touchless technology. So I'm sure people are already adapting to this, utilizing QR codes and utilizing this smartphones. So in the future, you'll be relying more on this when you're traveling through an airport and less on the traditional legacy systems. We'd also be remiss if we didn't tell you guys that we're thankful to our partners with the FAA. They donated over 50,000 face masks to the airport for our passengers for free of use. And New York State also donated 50,000 bottles of hand sanitizer for employees and the traveling public to utilize.
We have a couple of questions related to COVID testing and safety. One of which is from Cindy Martenfeld. She wanted to know if you guys would ever be implementing COVID testing at the airport, rapid COVID testing at the airport.
So
that's a great question.
Earlier, before Thanksgiving, well before Thanksgiving, we allow passengers coming off aircraft. We partnered with a group called AFC. It's a local urgent care. They have locations in Suffolk and Nassau County. And the travel quarantine orders are, on the fourth day, you must have a COVID test. And if it's negative, you can avoid the rest of the quarantine period, which is 14 days. So what we started to do is offer folks coming off that airplane the opportunity to make their appointment on the fourth day so that they could get their COVID test and comply with the New York State quarantine orders. But we don't see an advantage to doing testing at the airport at this point in time because it doesn't change the travel restrictions.
Okay. We have another question from Diane. She wants to know what the COVID procedure is for people that can't go through the security detectors. And also she's curious about the COVID testing for employees. And she's mentioning that the Albany Airport is working with SUNY on that. So I wondered if you had any comments there.
Actually, I had a discussion with the leadership of Albany Airport. And I was actually kind of surprised that they had decided to go ahead and do COVID testing on site at the airport. So here's the issue. You have people who are coming in who may have COVID and you're inviting them into the travel arena, right? And we don't know until they've been tested. So what happens with our quarantine orders for New York State, which I think they've organized them very well, is that 2 days before you travel, you have to have a negative COVID test. Then you get on your airplane. Then 4 days after, you have another COVID test. So which ensures that the airport environment stays clean. But if we're inviting everybody in to do actual COVID testing at the airport, you could be inviting sick people into your environment. So that's kind of a concern that we have about doing it here. The other issue is that we didn't want to have travelers have to come back to the airport, pay for parking and other things to get a COVID test here when they just traveled here. So they'd be better off doing it in their local community.
Got it. Katie, you, I believe, had a quick question. I unmuted you, so you should be able to ask your question now.
Sure. Hi, my name is Katie Bliss, and I have a question about would MacArthur Airport be a good fit for a new startup airline like the David Neeleman Airline Breeze?
Yes, Katie, that's an excellent question. Absolutely. And I'll tell you, if there's an airport out there that are not recruiting, you know, and really trying to get them to serve their airport, they've missed the boat. I think there's that airline is out there. There's a couple of other startup airlines that are also out there. Our job as airport managers are to, you know, develop relationships with people like that and try to recruit them to provide service at airports like ours.
Michael Candon is asking a question. Let me unmute him quickly.
Hi, Mike. Good to see you.
Hold on, Mike. Let me ask your question for...
I got it.
Oh, you got it? Okay.
Yeah, sorry about that. Yeah, hi, Shelly. Good to see you. Thanks for your service to Farmingdale State College on our Aviation Advisory Board. As you know, we have about 250 aviation students that are very nervous about their career. So really appreciated your calming effect recently at our board meeting. So thank you for that. Question on masks in the terminals. Have you had any passenger issues, people refusing to wear masks? Or I don't know if you said, are masks mandatory in the terminal?
Masks are mandatory in the terminal. We have lots of signage on the outside of the building. It gets a little confusing because if you are eating on an aircraft or in the terminal, obviously you can take your masks down. For the most part, I would say 99%, we have great compliance. You know, you always get those one or two folks who just, you know, don't want to participate, but we really do encourage them to wear their masks. One of our biggest hurdles was getting our employees to really do it. But once we got them to do it, and they have become true advocates of asking other folks to wear their mask as well. You know, you're not just protecting yourself, you're protecting others too. So it's really important. You all do a great job at SUNY, thanks. And I love serving on the Airport Advisory Board. And again, and I'll tell everybody who's on the line, Rob and I feel very strongly that airports like ours are going to recover, our industry is going to recover. There will continue to be a pilot shortage at some point in time. And, you know, and careers in aviation are great paying jobs. They keep people on Long Island, and it's really important the work that you all do too. Thanks.
Yeah, believe it or not, we've been able to continue flight training until last week when the numbers really spiked, but the students and instructors were wearing masks in the aircraft, learning how to adjust to that. So yeah, mask wearing, can't overstate how important it is.
So true.
Yep. I had a quick question, and again, if you have one, please go ahead and type your question in the chat, and I will unmute you so you could ask it. What routes do you think you guys are going to open up? You mentioned this business, you know, short-term business travel that you think is going to be an opportunity for you guys. What routes are you thinking and destinations are you thinking that's going to focus on?
Rob, you want to take our destinations and talk about how those get developed over time?
Sure. So we have a litany of destinations. We have 12 of them. Atlanta, Baltimore, Washington, Fort Lauderdale, Fort Myers, Orlando, Raleigh-Durham, Tampa, West Palm Beach, Miami, Myrtle Beach, and now Las Vegas. Those are all of our nonstop destinations. We think it's very important not to be armchair network planners for the airlines. So we don't go to the airlines and say, hey, we think we have a great opportunity to fly Islip to Sheboygan. We let the data speak for itself. So we do analytical work and we do data, and then we do meet with our airline partners, but we let them make the decisions. They will come to us and say, hey, we're looking at this type of destination. We're looking at serving New Orleans. And I'm only saying that as a hypothetical. We're not talking about New Orleans with any air carrier right now. And then we'll take that data, we'll run with it, we'll check something called PDUs, passengers daily each way. We look to see how many passengers are traveling from Nassau, Suffolk County. And then we do a profitability study for them where we look to make sure that if the airline elects to choose this service, that they're going to be profitable. Because it's important that if a carrier starts service, we don't want them to come in here, start a route, and then have it fail. Or furthermore, have an airline come in here, start up service, and then say, has historically happened at this airport. So we're really, really cautious with new service, new entrants, to make sure that before they pull the pin and operate these flights or a new carrier comes in and starts a presence, we want to make sure and make sure that they're super confident that the route and the carrier is going to be profitable.
Thank you. Do we have any more questions from the audience? We got time, I think, for one more before we wrap. Ernie?
Yes.
Did you want to say anything else before we wrap up, or?
No, I just want to compliment everybody. Rob, you produced a pretty comprehensive picture of what we're looking for. I want to thank Shelly and the supervisor and the whole function of the town. We've had a very good relationship with the town, and you know, the airport has been very important to our existence. In fact, LIMBA was formed. One of the reasons it was formed was to support the airport, and we once produced a program called "Use It or Lose It," and that was many years ago. And you guys are carrying the ball very well. Thank you.
We have one more quick question from the audience from Cindy Martenfeld. Cindy would like to know, when the COVID vaccine is available, will the airport be a site for vaccinations? That's a really great question too, I think.
Can I answer that? I was on a call yesterday with the governor's office, and actually communicating with them last night, offering up any sites that we have in the town to the state. But they are coordinating the distribution of the vaccine that's happening from the state level. So all we can do is let them know that we're willing partners. And, you know, certainly that could be a possible site, but there are many others across the town, across the county, that will be considered.
That's great. Thank you, Supervisor Carpenter. So just one quick thing before we've got about four more minutes. Wanted to do a quick plug. It's the holiday season, and normally during LIMBA, we all have an opportunity for our holiday party, which we couldn't have this year, to bring a toy to donate. We've actually been participating in the onlinetoydrive.org site, which we helped develop to essentially replace those in-person toy drives. A lot of the charitable organizations this year are really suffering from a lack of donations due to COVID, like everybody else. So if you guys have a minute, it's not too late to go to onlinetoydrive.org, check out some of the worthwhile organizations, and it only takes a couple of clicks to go ahead and make a donation there. And Ernie, did you want to talk about the next meeting?
Yeah, Jim Gorin is going to be our next speaker, and it's going to be on January 8th. And Jim is, I think this is his second term as a state senator. And we don't actually know at the moment exactly what he is going to be focused on, but I will be sending that out in a message within a week or so. So I think he's a very sincere man, and I think he's worth listening to. So I want to thank all of the people that have been participating in this morning's program and the all of the sponsors that make it all possible. We have programs right to the end of January, but we don't have anything scheduled for February. If anybody has some ideas that they'd like us to entertain as speakers, just let me know, and we'll see if that would fit in with our, our whole program thoughts. So, Lynn, thank you for administering this whole meeting. You've been very effective, and I think we've gotten the ideas conveyed that we wanted to get conveyed.
Well, thank you, everybody, and I'll give Commissioner LaRose one last quick plug. You can wrap us. We got literally about 30 seconds left before we're right on time to wrap. And happy holidays to everybody.
Supervisor, do you want to wrap up?
Yeah, please.
Really just to Ernie and everyone at LIMBA for helping keep the name of the airport out there and keeping the business sector moving. We thank you. I just wish everyone an absolutely wonderful, blessed and happy, healthy holiday season of a new year filled with everything but COVID. And just keep your minds open to getting the vaccine. I think it's going to require an education process because there are some, you know, misinformation out there. People are nervous about it, concerned about it. I actually contacted my physician and he said, get it as soon as you can. So with that, I wish everyone an absolutely wonderful, happy holiday, remembering that we're in this together just 6 feet apart.
On behalf of LIMBA, we wish you a very, very good holiday season and keep healthy, folks. We love you.
Same here.
Thanks, everybody.
Thanks, Shelly. Thank you, Rob.
Thank you.
Stay well. Happy holidays.
Happy holidays.
Bye-bye.
All right, I'm ending the meeting. Okay.